Good morning and very, very welcome to this webinar about antibiotic resistance in the Anthropocene. My name is Sharon Joma and I'm a journalist with the public radio and television here in Stockholm. We are about 150 participants checking in right now from Sweden, of course, but also from UK, from the Netherlands, Norway, Italy, all of you very, very welcome. We will meet and listen to leading experts in various areas, and you will also have your opportunity to talk to the experts in different chat rooms in about an hour and a half. But first of all, I would like to welcome the organizers of this webinar. Maria Smith, welcome. You're the Secretary General of Axfoundation. What is your intention with this webinar? What are your hopes?
Well, thank you very much. Both we at Axfoundation and Prosperous Planet thought that it was a quite good idea to gather a bunch of really not knowledgeable people and just listen to them and their discussion regarding the problem, but foremost the potential solution related to antibiotic resistance. So by doing this, we hope that all of us together will increase knowledge about this quite complex issue. And of course, we also hope that we will level some engagement and level up the engagement regarding innovative solutions. And last but not least, we also hope that maybe we can increase our networks and maybe draw some connections with others who are also really interested in this important topic.
Wonderful. Elin Enfors-Kautsky, founder and CEO of Prosperous Planet, also one of the two organizers. Good morning.
Good morning, Sharon and Maria and everyone else.
Good morning. Why have you decided to organize this?
At Prosperous Planet, we help companies address these kind of complex and intertwined challenges that are so typical of the Anthropocene. And I think antibiotic resistance is a prime example of such a challenge. It has multiple sources of origin. It produces cascading effects across different sectors, across different regions of the world. And any individual solution by nature is just part of the solution. It's never more than partial. Yet that's typically the kind of sustainability challenges that we're facing today. And what we do know about these problems, these wicked problems, is that we need new kinds of approaches to deal with them. Our usual ways of working is not enough to tackle antibiotic resistance or climate change for that matter. So we need novel thinking, we need innovation, and we need new types of collaboration. And I think that starts with new conversations. And that is what I hope that we will have here today.
New collaborations and new ideas for solutions. Thank you. And Maria, Axfoundation, do you have the same kind of ideas of new collaboration and ideas?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we call ourselves a do tank rather than a think tank at Axfoundation. Oh. And that's because we are focusing on actually developing concrete and scalable solutions for more sustainable development. And due to that, but also due to the fact that antibiotic resistance, I mean, it's a problem no one can solve alone. So collaboration is key. New solutions is key. So that's why we think that this webinar is a step in that direction.
A step. And back to Elin, could you please give us some background about this challenge, this huge problem, so we know where we are today?
Yes. Yeah, and I have this little slide to go with that broad overview. So as you all know, the spread of antibiotic resistance is a growing problem around the world to the extent that it's becoming existential for us, as it's threatening many types of modern healthcare as we know it. And this problem has many sources of origins, many underlying drivers. So it is related to human overuse in prescriptions, to misuse, but also how we use antibiotics preventive and in non-therapeutic ways when we produce animals on land and as well at sea, which we will hear more about later. The problem is also related to horticulture. I think that's an area that has often been overlooked in the past, but it's also, of course, a problem of relating to how we produce these drugs. And if we look at this on a global level, about 70% of the antibiotics that we use are for animal production. But this is a number that has great variations around the world. So in Sweden, that number is only 13%. Yet, this is very much a global problem, and that's related to the hyper-connectivity of the world today, how we travel, how we trade, and so on. And there are also a number of aggravating factors that makes this problem so particularly difficult to solve. One thing is that this cross-scale nature of it leads to us struggling to find good governance arrangements to handle this. Another issue is that it's so complex, so we actually have a hard time quantifying it. Like, what is the cost of this problem? What will it be? And because of this, it's become, because of this intangible nature of it, people end up debating the exact or the accuracy of the numbers, diverting attention from where it's actually needed. And then there's another thing around this trap mechanism that has been at play for a while now, where there is quite little research and development into the new development of new antibiotics because of low incentives. And that is because of, the expected return on investment is low because of the very problem of resistance. So there you have really this kind of self-reinforcing feedback. And taking all together, the consequences of this problem is, of course, staggering. Today, there are about 700,000 people that die every year due to this problem. But within a few decades, we can expect that 10 million people might die a year from antibiotics resistance. And the cost of this, the societal cost of this, is just enormous. It might go beyond $100 trillion by that time. So to sum things up, this is by no means a trivial problem that we're talking about today. And I think we'll spend now a bit, the part of this first session, on digging a bit deeper into understanding this multifaceted problem.
Thank you. 10 million people dying in a year, that's an enormous amount of people. What we would talk about will be also what is needed for this to slow down, to stop, actually. But now, let's get on with this morning show. We will start with the problem, or the main challenge. We already heard a little bit about it. And we will start with the human aspects of antibiotics. Helle Ågård is the Deputy Director of REACT Europe. Good morning, Helle. Are you there?
I'm here, yes. Good morning, everyone. Okay, thank you so much for letting me opening the show. I'll start off by explaining some of the consequences that will be of antibiotic resistance on human health and try to provide also some global perspectives as well. So I'll start off by showing this antibiotics pyramid, and what you can see from there is antibiotic resistance is not just making it harder for us to treat common infections, wound infections, pneumonia, blood infections, etc. Effective antibiotics are really sort of the cornerstones of modern medicine as we know it, and they're used both for treatment but also to prevent infection, for example, during surgery. And without effective antibiotics, all of these elements that you're seeing in front of you of modern medicine will become much more risky, or some even impossible to perform. And as you can see from the little black lines on the antibiotics below the pyramid there, the cornerstones are really beginning to crumble. And we currently have no real alternative or truly new antibiotics in the pipeline to replace them. just to sort of give a bit of perspective how broad the effects are or who is affected on this, I can just give a personal note that 2 years ago, when I had just gone through a very long and complicated delivery, I developed a very high fever during surgery afterwards, and the doctors suspected sepsis. and started antibiotic treatment on the spot. And obviously today, I can't even think the thought through of what would have happened if the antibiotics that I had received back then hadn't worked. Another example that I want to pull out today, and that was at the top of the pyramid there, is the impact on cancer treatment. Some cancer patients receive numerous different antibiotic treatments when going through treatment to keep infections at bay when their own immune system is suppressed by chemotherapy or just treatment in general. And a recent study from the Longitude Prize, which surveyed 100 oncologists in the UK, found that almost 70% of the surveyed oncologists thought that some cancer treatments would be obsolete in just 10 years from now due to resistance. Yet, if we're looking sort of on the policy side, the recent plan for the EU, which is, you know, has a mission to conquering cancer and aims to save at least 3 million lives by 2030, it doesn't even mention antibiotic resistance in one sentence. So there's a mismatch there. Beyond the impact on human health, a number of the sustainable development goals are also threatened by antibiotic resistance. Goals on reducing poverty, hunger, addressing inequality, creating sustainable economic growth, protecting the environment, they will all be negatively affected. And in 2018, the World Bank estimated that the cost of inaction on AMR would actually be on par with that of climate change, and potentially even a little worse, by up to 3.8% of global GDP. So we're currently at a fork in the road where we either act and pay now, or we will have to pay much more later in terms of spending, economic losses, and the loss of human life. So I'll stop there.
Thank you. An enormous problem that we seem to understand the consequences fully. Why do you think not more is done then? Why is this not more of an urgent common issue today?
Well, I think there's a number of reasons for that. We lack appropriate data. Antibiotic resistance isn't a disease per se. So we don't have the same kind of civil society, for example, as we have for cancer and for other diseases. There's no human face to the problem. And all of that contributes to it not getting the political attention that it needs. And, you know, if COVID-19 is sort of, if we're making an analogy, COVID-19 is a tsunami that's coming at us. Antibiotic resistance is more like rising sea levels. So it's happening slowly, but once the full impact is there, you know, the negative consequences on the world as we know it will be really dramatic.
Thank you very much, Helle Ågård from React Europe. And from human aspects of antibiotic resistance, we will go to animal husbandry. As we heard, animals account for almost 70 to 80% of all use of antibiotics. Welcome, Professor Ulf Magnusson from the Swedish University of Agricultural Science. Good morning to you, Ulf.
Thank you, Sharon, and good morning, everyone. A little bit about the issue first. As said here, the livestock sector is the largest user of antibiotics worldwide. And this is because people in that sector use antibiotics for disease prevention and also for growth promotion. This doesn't happen in human medicine, so to say. In Sweden, it's just though some 12-13% of the total use are for animals. And also we are consistently having the lowest use per animal unit in the European Union for many, many, many years. And this is thanks to the hard work by Swedish farmers supported by Swedish veterinarians. And our skills in that is highly asked for internationally. We are supporting the UN system in this. We are running massive open online courses supported by Axfoundation, by the way. Participants from all over the world with some more than 3,000 participants at the moment. So there is a transfer of resistant bacteria from livestock and animal source food. But how frequent is this? The risk, the magnitude of this issue, that is not clear. saying this, I think it's very, very wise to have a precautionary principle here in lowering the use of antibiotics in the livestock sector. So, because also that antibiotics resistance is an animal health issue. It doesn't work for sick animals, and we're jeopardizing both animal welfare and their productivity. I think that is important to remember. So a little bit about solutions or possible solutions to elaborate around that. The World Bank very recently, actually last week, in a webinar we arranged, there are tremendous economic benefits in investing in containing the antibiotic resistance emergence. There are enormous returns in this. But as we all know, and as Helle indicated also, there is no glory in preparedness. It's very hard to generate public pressure on this. Politicians and everyone is, we are fire brigade people. And also in, especially in low-income countries or emerging economies where I'm working, legal frameworks and regulations are good, but what about where the compliance is poor and the resources for enforcement of these are scarce? It's good foundation, but it's we need more to do. So another way is the Watergate trick to follow the money. Who is doing benefits on using antibiotics? It's the farmers, it's quite cheap. It's veterinarians and animal health personnel that are selling antibiotics, agrochemical shops and so on and so on. So these are alternative modes than compared to the frameworks of regulations and so on. And finally, what about consumers and traders' pressure? What we see in emerging economies that large companies trying to apply more prudent use because that opens an export market for them. So there is a mechanism there. Thanks.
Thank you, Ulf. Should we not eat meat from other countries then?
I think so. Consumers?
Sorry?
I think so. If they have good animal ethics, welfare, and if they... use less antibiotics when they produce. But this antibiotic-free thing, which you see in commercials and so, that is nonsense. It's highly unethical not to treat animals with antibiotics if they are sick.
That leaves a lot of responsibility on us consumers then to understand. There are policies in place in many, many countries. Is this not enough to regulate?
No, I think if you are governing a poor resource country, maybe you put your money or your priorities in other things instead.
Like what?
Food security, education for children, etc., etc.
So whose responsibility would it be to sort of help out in the low-income countries when where this is not in place?
Yeah, we are working a lot, but I think this is a global issue. It's truly a global issue. It's like pandemics and so on. So I think it's the global community, donors from richer countries supporting these activities. And there are such activities, but maybe it should be increased, I think.
Thank you very much, Ulf. And now we go from animals, above the water to fish and to aquaculture. And I would like to welcome Max Troell, PhD and Associate Professor, Bayer Institute and Stockholm Resilience Center. Good morning, Max, how are you?
Good morning, Sharon, I'm fine, thank you. Thank you very much. I would like to start putting aquaculture into a little bit broader perspective because it's not clear for everyone what aquaculture is, but it is very important at the global scale. Now it provides more than 20% of the global animal protein. And globally, if we look at wild fish stocks, they are fished at full capacity, so we cannot expand more there. And that's why aquaculture becomes more important. And today we actually receive more than half of our seafood from aquaculture. And there's a great potential for further expansion. So in the future, more fish will come from aquaculture. So that's the broader perspective. But there are many challenges, and one challenge relates to the use of antibiotics. And as within the agriculture sector, antibiotics are provided through feeds. And to some extent, we know what antibiotics are being used at the global scale and how these varies between different farm species. But there are a great diversity of species and systems globally. So it's really difficult to get a good overview. And we don't have enough information to tell how much is being used at the global scale. So there are a big lack of understanding at that scale. We even know less about the resistance being developed from these systems. So that's also a more of a black box. But we know that there are critically antibiotics for humans that are being used. So there are many reasons, and Ulf mentioned some for misuse and overuse of antibiotics. And it relates to knowledge, to farm practice, access to veterinarians, and also the suppliers, existence of vaccine, etc. But there are also rules and practical use that are set up, and they target on prescription by veterinarians, no preventive use, no growth simulation use, rules for how it's being applied, farm documentation, etc. So there are rules and practical use in place. So one positive example is from the salmon industry, where they in Norway managed to reduce use to almost zero in their salmon industry. And that's thanks to a developed vaccine. But if we look at this slide, we can see that in other countries where they farm salmon, it's not the same pattern. They are still using a lot of antibiotics, even though it's the same species, indicating that also where you farm is important to how efficient and vaccine can be and other diseases that are in that environment. So I think I stop there.
Thank you, Max. What do you think is needed for all the salmon farmers, for example, to reduce antibiotics in the same way as in Norway? I mean, what needs to be in place for this?
Yeah, I mean, different species, different systems in different regions will have different challenges. And the salmon industry has actually joined forces. They come together, the big producers, trying to tackle different environmental problems. And antibiotics is one of their challenges as well. And also, if you look at the even larger scale, there are initiatives, and we are part of one initiative where the 10 largest seafood companies in the world are trying to address different aspects of sustainability. And they have 10 different aims, commitments that they will try and fulfill. And to reduce antibiotics is one high up on their list. So that's what we are trying to work with them. And so that's a good example of how science can interact with the industry to join forces to come up to different kind of solutions.
Join forces seems to be the golden words here today, but the low-income countries here, do you see the main differences here too? How do we include all the industries in this?
Yeah, that's a good question. And as Ulf also indicated, that is a challenge with all these small-scale farmers that are everywhere, very difficult to have any kind of monitoring in place, but they are important because there are lots of cases where they use antibiotics in ways that are not sustainable. There is a lack of veterinarian prescription, etc. So that's a huge challenge also in aquaculture.
Thank you very much, Max, for your presentation. Thank you. All right, we will go along here with innovation and system thinking. The role of innovation and system thinking might be two important solutions for one of these big challenges for humanity. We will hear from Saba Atefyakte, CTO and co-founder of Amferia. Good morning. Hi.
Good morning. So let's start with that. As we know, the world is approaching this antibiotic resistance a little bit too fast. And of course, we need innovation to tackle this global problem. But when we talk about innovation, what do we really mean? And when that innovation can turn into a solution? For that, let's have a quick look at the history of the antibiotics and see why we need innovation. So right after the discovery of penicillin, that was a golden time where a lot of antibiotics were discovered and saved lives. But soon after usage of any all of them, the resistance started to emerge and spread. So when we talk about an innovation gap, we usually refer to the years between 1960 to 2000s, where there was almost no antibiotics discovered. But even today, we are still in an urgent need for new antibiotics to fight those resistance. And so that this innovation gap automatically is connected to the discovery void in the antibiotics. So why the void is even there from the beginning? So first of all, there are of course hurdles into bringing antibiotics. First is that the research and development is quite risky since the resistance can arise again and develop so fast and make more complex problems. The other thing is that, let's say, sort of the low-hanging fruits are already been picked, so it's much harder job to find new antibiotics. And also, with all these hurdles, this business is not profitable because they usually prescribe for a short period of time, and even if powerful antibiotic is developed, is usually guarded and only be used in the worst-case scenarios. So that has left very few incentives for development of new antibiotic drugs. We have to, just thinking about this challenge, we also have to ask this question from ourselves, that are developing new antibiotics all we have to focus on as well? Of course, that is an essential strategy on a way to fight this global challenge, but we need something in the pipeline. But once keep saying that we are in crying need for antibiotics, we should be aware of the fact that our problem is not about the lack of antibiotics. It's about the fact that the antibiotics we have don't work. And another thing is that this problem is very multidimensional, as other panelists just mentioned that, and we're talking about everything within human, animals, food, sewage, and environment. And for that, we need to think of innovation as a multidimensional aspect. So there is a need to encourage innovation from a broader audience than rather just traditional research settings, and bring novel ideas to be developed into solution to help to solve this problem on antibiotic resistance. So let's think of innovation as a puzzle, and that puzzle have different pieces that need to come together to make a solution. For example, one piece can be to look at innovation in a way to not just bring a product, but change a practice or a service in a better way. And the other one can be to look for new alternatives for antibiotics, which are very ongoing in the world and has its own challenges. But I want to pinpoint two of the more neglected piece of that puzzle. For example, the diagnostics innovation. We can be much better at identifying, monitoring, and tracking antibiotic resistance. These tests can help us to prevent unnecessary antibiotic usage or use the most targeted antibiotic. So we need those to be able to use what we have in a better way. And the other one, which I am a fan of truly, is preventive innovation. I think that prevention is core. It is basic, but if we prevent infection, we simply prevent the spread of resistance that needs to happen. And like modern medicine, as Helle said, for example, now we have a lot of procedures coming with hip, knee, chemotherapies, and all the surgical procedures that could be, like, prevention is the key when it comes to them to avoid an infection. I, for one, and also it's very important to mention that prevention is much further than good hygiene and good isolation practices, and it's totally being misguided nowadays in the clinical settings where they pour antibiotic into the IV of the patient only to avoid an infection. So I have worked with infection prevention for several years, both in academia and now in our new company, Amferia, which I want to put in as an example. And at Amferia, we basically develop preventive medical devices. So the thought behind finding Amferia was that we believe that nature has already given us hints for the development of the solution against these hard-to-kill bacteria. In nature and living organisms, there are small types of molecule called antimicrobial peptides, for example, that can selectively kill bacteria, including those antibiotic-resistant ones. So our innovation, and that happens by just disrupting the cell membrane. So our innovation is to embed these peptides and their killing mechanisms into material that can rapidly kill all type of bacteria. And they, if they can use in the form of medical devices, they can prevent the infection. For example, one focus that we have is within the wound care, which prevention is a big problem, and use these material, for example, as wound patches. And we believe also that the challenge of antibiotic resistance requires a One Health perspective that takes into account the connection between human, animal health and environment. This approach is needed because bacteria and bacterial genes often have the ability to move between all these compartments. We also believe that by stepping into this journey, like any solutions, we become part of a big value chain and become partners with different entities and individuals, whether they are scientists, healthcare professionals, or policymakers, or even people who would use this innovation in the future. So we must find a way to unite, to learn from one another, and support each other to scale up these ideas to address the global threat. So the last thing that's very important is that innovation in itself does not solve the problem. Innovation needs to apply it in a correct manner in order to make an impact. And this transition is a real challenge. And we need right technology translation, right policy measures, economic stimuli, and all of these to minimize the barrier for that development. And with this, I want to pass the word to Elin, which will want to share insights, valuable insights on the role of system thinking related to that. Thank you.
Thank you, Saba. So what I'm going to try to do now in the coming minutes is to reflect a bit on what Saba just said from a systems thinking perspective. And I'm going to use this iceberg model that you can see here to the left to explain what I mean with this. So I think over the past years, we've spent a lot of time focusing here on the tip of the iceberg. We have reacted to the fact that antibiotic resistance is spreading by producing new or trying to produce new antibiotics. But that is kind of like adding water to a leaking bucket. It will buy us some time, but it doesn't get to the bottom of that problem because new resistance is developing all the time. So what we need to do is to move down the iceberg and look at the underlying drivers here, to look for leverage points that are deeper down. So we have to ask ourselves the questions, why do we get so much resistance? That's one of the questions. The other one is, why is that such a big problem for us? And we need to redirect our focus to think more about those kinds of innovations that can target these deep leverage points. And as we do this, as we move down through the iceberg, what happens then is that we also reconceptualize this problem. So antibiotic resistance goes from being a purely technical and purely scientific problem to becoming more of a broader human problem. And what that does is that it also opens up for new kinds of solutions to this problem, because then it becomes clear that only policy responses, which is the authoritarian approach to solving a problem, or only competitive approaches, like chemical companies racing to create a new drug, will not be able to target this kind of multitude of underlying driving forces. To get at that, we need these collaborative approaches. So, and the reason we do that is that because we need to rewire the entire system, and rewiring a system requires collaboration. And this, I mean, I understand this sounds fairly theoretical, but I'll just, there are actually some quite practical approaches for how to go about that. I'll just, you know, hint you towards one of these models, so how you can think about that addressing such a complex challenge. And one of the useful ones, I think, is looking to this triple focused lens on leverage points, deep leverage points, agency, and opportunity. And I think the first question that we must ask ourselves where are these deep leverage points, and what combination of innovations can address those deep leverage points to open up for a new development trajectory. So if it is, for example, the animal protein value chain that we're trying to rewire, the question is, what is the combination of innovations that will open up for a new direction of that system? Once we have an idea about that, we also have to think about what are the actors that jointly can influence those deep leverage points. And this is really about understanding what the collaborative ecosystem looks like that both makes this new development trajectory possible and profitable, that makes it work in reality. So here we're talking about much more than just the policy response. It could be things like, you know, shifting the way we produce the food, but also what we want to eat, the demand behind it. So, and the third part here is, of course, what does the opportunity context for change look like? So picking up on what Saba said, making it work in reality. I think often the innovations we think about, they fail, not because the innovations are bad per se, but because the timing is wrong. And so here, I think what we need to do is to actively create the windows of opportunity that we need to make the innovations go to scale. So with that kind of broad overview, focusing on the deep leverage points, the collaborative ecosystems, and creating windows of opportunity for change, with that in back of our mind, I think we can now move on to looking at some of the more concrete solutions that some of the other panelists will talk about.
Thank you, Elin. Thank you, Saba. A short question to both of you, if you can shortly. You are talking about opportunity and timing. Today, we all are worried about, and our minds and souls are full of COVID-19. How do you break out of this COVID-19 place and also create opportunity for innovations and interest in innovation for this issue?
A short reflection on that for my part. I think, I mean, this, while there is of course nothing good with this pandemic, I think there it does provide such a window of opportunity for changing the conversation, actually, because we know that we get exposed to more and more pandemics that is related to fundamental sustainability challenges like deforestation, like climate change, intensive animal husbandry, and so on. So I mean, this, what we're facing right now, is very much a sustainability related catastrophe. And I think there is a space for pointing to that right now, pointing to the systemic implications and the underlying drivers. And I think it's seen in the media a little bit, and we're starting to discuss it, but I think we can broaden that and bring that up. And that would also enable these kinds of different approaches to also other problems like climate change, like antibiotics resistance, and so on.
Thank you, Saba.
I also agree with Elin on that. And I think that this is this COVID, I'm not going to call it opportunity because it's bad, but then maybe it was a warm up for us to understand how we should behave in the next level.
Thank you very much. An opportunity, an open up, maybe. We will go to solutions. We will start with the environmental aspect of drugs, such as antibiotics, of course. And the responsibility both of industry and the consumers. Welcome, Cecilia De Pedro. She's the Director of Sustainability at Apoteket Hjärtat, one of Sweden's largest pharmacy chains.
Thank you. Lovely to be here. Really interesting talks. I'm learning a lot. I will have a few minutes talking about pharmaceuticals. And specifically how they reach environment and antibiotics specifically, and also the drivers behind resistant bacteria. So I will cover actually three areas, but most dig into two in these few minutes I have with you. And one of them, as you can see, is you see the factory on the right-hand side, and that comes the medicine number one to the use of the humans. So that's one piece I will cover a little bit. Then, and that's also how a resistance can be generated in the worst case if you use antibiotics in the wrong way. and not in a proper way. So I'll come back to that very soon. The second one is, of course, if you somehow antibiotics reach the environment, either through the toilet or through landfill, number two. I will not dig in very much into that piece, but of course, that's also very problematic that directly through the what's excreted through our bodies that can reach the environment. But the third piece is actually a piece that I discovered myself 15 years ago. So this is a long time ago, where I discovered very high levels of pharmaceuticals, actually antibiotics reaching the environmentally directly from the pharmaceutical factories. And I think that was something nobody could ever imagine, that big pharmacy, big factories around the world, and specifically this was in India, would release antibiotics in such high levels directly into the environment. They're trying to treat it, but it was not in a good way. And so it was released directly to the environment. So actually number one and number three are some very important sources of that we can also find very easily solutions to stop the resistance reaching the antibiotics reaching the nature. So the use of antibiotics, this is one piece that we humans actually can do ourselves. And I think most of us are probably a little bit aware about that, but I think it's very it's worth repeating that never use antibiotics unnecessarily. I think in Sweden we're quite good at that, but and other parts of the world, and also sometimes in Sweden, that we have to be aware that you can have a viral infection. So don't insist on having antibiotics. Still, that's a situation we can have, that people want the disease to go over. The second one is actually to complete the treatment. It's visible that many people stop taking the treatment when you see the first signs of recovery. And what happens then is that even if you can have signs of recovery, it's generated resistant bacteria in your body, a few of them still are alive. So it's very important to continue the whole course to not generate resistance in the body, and that those few bacteria can become resistant of the antibiotics. And also it's very important, of course, to leave the rest. If you have something rest, leave it to the pharmacy. In Sweden, we have this system that you can leave it to the pharmacy. So we take care of it and it's incinerated, so it doesn't reach the environment through landfill or toilet. So those three steps, I think we would reach very far if around the world we will follow these three rules when using antibiotics. I wanted to show you this movie, so please run it.
This medicine is made from water. Water polluted by pharmaceutical factories. The manufacturing of medicinal drugs is a billion-dollar industry. And Hyderabad in India is one of the biggest manufacturing cities. According to reports, the factories here are dumping their waste straight into the rivers, polluting the water in the areas where millions of people live. This is denied by the industry, so we decided to prove it. We collected water, analyzed it, and extracted the active substances, resulting in an entirely new kind of medicine. A cocktail made from drugs found in the water. Each of these pills contain active substances that are used to treat fungal infections, hypertension, severe pain, epilepsy, cancer, and HIV. Would you take this medicine? Unfortunately, this is what the factories are exposing the environment and the locals to. It's time to question how our medicine is manufactured. That's why we have launched this label, a first step towards a more sustainable pharmaceutical manufacturing. Download the full report and follow the initiative at hardpilltoswallow.se.
So the third piece of releasing pharmaceuticals to the environment is actually from factories. And this is still a problem 15 years later since I discovered this back. So we're now struggling together with others in the industry to find solutions to this. And it's not probably very difficult, actually. It's just about cleaning the water. So in the we are trying to influence politicians, change regulations globally that we have to put incitements in place to ensure that there are environmental demands on the factories, not only to produce at the most cheapest level. So I think with this is my last word, covering the most important pieces of how antibiotics can reach the environment through directly from medicine. So you can see also an example of an article in Aftonbladet, and also the campaign that we made that you just saw last year, that we're trying to influence politicians to enhance and put more regulations in place, at least in Sweden to start with. Thanks.
Thank you. What kind of regulation would you like to see in place then?
In Sweden today, when it comes to prescribed drugs as antibiotics, there's no environmental demands at all. We have only the cheapest are the most that we recommend when you come to the pharmacy. And this saves, of course, a lot of money to the state in Sweden. We would like to put environmental demands as a requisite to sell drugs in Sweden, and not only the cheapest ones. So this is one that would be quite easy solution to at least start with in Sweden.
Did you get any reactions on this easy solution to start with?
Yes, there is an action from a few politicians, so they're looking to see how they can put this in place. That has happened 7 years ago, but it never reached a regulation. So I'm really hoping that this time will be the moment that we can at least start the regulation from a Swedish perspective. But the global is not really solved yet.
Well, at least we will hear very soon from Sweden and policies. Thank you very much for an interesting presentation. Thanks. Yes, as close to the political power as we can get this morning in Sweden, at least. Welcome, Deputy Director, Swedish Ministry of Enterprise Innovation, Gunilla Eklund. Good morning.
Good morning to everyone in the audience. Thanks for having me this morning. So getting back briefly to the problem statement from this morning. So we know that resistance is triggered by misuse of antimicrobials in all sectors, in the human health sector, in the crop production sector, and in animal husbandry. And on your left-hand side of this slide, the spread of resistance to the community is symbolized by this tap and this dropping resistance onto community, if you so wish. So the challenge would be to control this tap. And the question is, what is the solution to do so? Well, there is no one easy solution. This is a complex problem. We all know that. So there is a need for a complex solution as well. But in theory, it isn't that very difficult. If you move on to your right-hand side, the five R's give you guidance. If you use the right drug, the right dose and right duration and onset on the right time and use the right route of administration, you actually control this tap. There is a more conclusive way of expressing this. You could say that you should use as little as possible, but as much as necessary to safeguard various stuff, various things. I can get back to that later. So controlling this tap in high-income countries with resources and strong infrastructures, there are usually rules and regulations in place, and often you have guidelines that further voluntary guidance that further makes your life easier, which enables you to control this tap. For example, in the European Union, the agriculture sector, which I represent, is mainly governed by harmonized common EU rules. So these are rules on animal health and welfare, on food safety, and also on how you are allowed to use veterinary medicines in livestock, for example. So all the member states of the European Union follow the same binding rules to ensure harmonized conditions and also to ensure the free movement within the common market. But if you move at a global level, there aren't always rules and regulations, binding rules in place, but you do have international normative standards on food and animal production. And these are often developed by the WHO, FAO, or OIE, or the tripartite together. There are also other stakeholders. These standards are normative, and they can be used by countries that lack these strong infrastructures. They don't have strong enough infrastructures to have rules and regulations in place, but they can use these standards to be part of the world trade of agriculture products. And secondly, these standards are also guiding in trade frictions that might sometimes have to be sorted by the World Trade Organization. And in Sweden, we have on your top right a strategy to combat antibiotic resistance. And for those of you who are not familiar with that, that picture is clickable. And I'm also happy to dive into this strategy later in the breakout session. But it's this strategy is a roadmap of what the government wants to achieve when it comes to combating antimicrobial resistance, and how we tackle the problem and how we tackle this challenge of controlling the TAP within the government offices. And in the bottom right, you see a jigsaw puzzle, and the components are those that are the key components in the Swedish model on how to tackle antimicrobial resistance in animal production and in food production. Thank you, and over.
Thank you, Gunilla Eklund. So you told us about a little bit about the Swedish strategy, but what does the Swedish government do internationally to be a part of the solution of this problem?
Yeah, so the Swedish government, to be part of the solution, I mean, as I said, this is a complex problem. It requires complex solutions. So first of all, the Swedish government gives priority to the problem as such. And the government collaborates across, if you look at the national level, across political parties. Also within the parliament, there is a consensus on the objectives and goals of the strategy. And if you have a strong base like that, you can push from within. You push in the EU negotiations on rules and regulations, and you also push and work in the UN organizations, for example. I can also give examples on concrete.
Yes, please give us a brief example.
There are many levels, but if you look at the government offices, we have interdepartmental working groups that regularly get together. We don't work in silos. We work together with all the relevant ministries to get a One Health approach on the problem. And the government also, now I'm stepping out of to what the government does. It makes investments in different things. Tagging on to what the previous speaker, for example, in the budget for next year, there are investments on advanced wastewater treatment. So those kinds of investments there are. And we're also sending people to the UN system, secondments to FAO, for example, WHO, UNDP, to work from the inside, sharing best practices, because Sweden is a small country, but we are certainly a champion of tackling AMR, and our Swedish model and our Swedish ways of working needs to be spread.
Thank you very much, Gunilla Eklund, Deputy Director, Swedish Ministry of Enterprise Innovation, a long name there, thank you.
Thank you.
We will get on and get back to Maria Smith, Secretary General of Axfoundation. Welcome back. We heard from all of the speakers today that collaboration, the idea of collaboration, has been very important. And you will talk about your antibiotic criteria, right?
Exactly. So collaboration is like butter in my ears. I don't know if you say that in English, but you know, it's really a word that I've heard many times this morning, and it just makes me very happy. I'm going to give you an example of how we work, a concrete and practical solution that we developed together with many others. I will start by taking you back to how it all started. And it was this question that was raised to us at Axfoundation. What can we do to reduce the use of antibiotics in food production, and how do we encourage others to do the same? So this frank question was asked by actually Åsa Domeij at Axfood, who will talk in just a few minutes' time. And I think it was raised about 7 years ago. And I think that was really a starting point of our work with antibiotics and the collaboration that we do within this area. And so what we did was that we gathered a bunch of people, a bunch of organizations that we saw really was important in order to get this work started. And you can see several of the organizations on the slide. We've been working with an expert group with representatives from academia and research. And we've been working with a broad reference group with companies from food retail, from food service, etc. But also when it comes to organizations from NGO side, from trade organizations, authorities, etc. And this has really been key in order to develop a solution that does not only work in theory, but also in practice. So what have we done? I will just briefly give you an overview of the antibiotic criteria tools that we call them. In about this summer, this group of organizations finalized our work with the updated version and the version 2.0. And actually what the tools consist of is a number of criteria that addresses certain important areas when it comes to antibiotic use in food production. It focuses on production of meat, dairy, and seafood. And the aim is to ensure that antibiotics is used in a more responsible way, not only here, but all around the world, since food is a very global trade. And what we have done is that we have, through these criteria, developed a practical hands-on tool that purchasers or organization that purchases food can use in dialogue with their suppliers and follow up, but also putting and setting requirements. And each of these criteria is also associated with a number of questions that can easily make almost anyone more of an antibiotic savvy person. So you can have this dialogue and spread the knowledge, but also spread and push the boundaries far beyond legislation. And as of today, the antibiotic criteria tools is used by several food retailers, several food service companies in Sweden, and also some food producers. And of course, we hope that more companies will use them, since they really target a good area and an important area. So to finalize, I think I just wanted to raise this example of a solution, since it's innovative. It's also a proof of the solution that it can actually create not only societal value, but also business value. But I think the foremost reason I wanted to highlight this solution is because I think it's a very good example of the kind of broad collaborations that we need to do more of in the future. Yes.
How important do you think the businesses are in order to make a sustainable change for this issue?
Yeah, I think at least my personal experience is that in many times, I mean, collaboration, we've heard that this morning and it's starting to really happen. But I think it's so easy to just continue working with your own sector, because working with the same organizations that you worked with yesterday is maybe the easiest way forward, but we need to challenge ourselves. And I think there's true potential in seeing business as a driving force for change. Talking about implementation and making the solution enter into implementation and reaching all the way out, I think business is really important in that sense.
And how interested do you find the businesses today, in Sweden at least?
Well, I think, I mean, this is an example of today. We have several actors from the companies, from the business society here. I think many companies in Sweden and globally are working with these issues. So I think, yeah, I think it's absolutely, there's an interest.
Thank you very much, Maria Smith, Secretary General, Axfoundation. Thank you. And Maria mentioned Åsa Domeij, Head of Sustainability at Axfood. And we will continue with focusing on retail, food and antibiotics, and of course, the need of joint politics and collaboration, the golden words this morning. Åsa Domeij, good morning to you.
Hi. I'm going to give you some perspectives from food retail. First, why is it important for food retail? And there is a simple answer. More antibiotics worldwide is used for healthy animals than for sick people. So that's why it's very relevant for us within food retail. And how would consumers react if they really knew that society threatens human healthcare in order to just be able to eat meat a little bit cheaper? And my answer is that most people would get really upset and they would ask for more measures from food retail and more legislation. And actually, Helle also compared it with a climate crisis. She talked about rising sea levels. And I really think that the issue of antibiotics resistance is really comparable to the climate crisis when it comes to the destiny of mankind. It's a collective problem, and it's not enough with responsibility from businesses or consumers. There is really a need for legislation and political decisions as well. And Maria has already said a little about how it started, but one thing that was really important was that we got statistics on the use of antibiotics within food industry on the European level. Because when we had facts, we could start a discussion within the food retail companies, it was easier to start a cooperation. And another thing that was really good was that growth promotion and the use of antibiotics within growth promotion was banned in Sweden already in 1986. Before that, Sweden had a much higher level of use within agriculture. And that proved that it's really possible to reduce the use of food antibiotics. And as Maria already said, within Axfood and Axfoundation started a discussion. And then an expert group was formed, led by Axfoundation. And we got the first common criteria for food retail in 2014. And just shortly about the principles. It's really important with a high standard of animal welfare and hygiene. I mean, healthy animals don't need antibiotics at all. Another principle is that big animals shouldn't be group treated. There should be available documentation and it should be prescribed by a veterinary. And we shouldn't at all have breeding where most animals need treatment. Even if we have these principles within food retail, it's not enough because all responsibility can't be taken by businesses and consumers. We need political decision, stronger legislation, and these principles and the criteria we have within food retail could actually be a basis for more decision making for example, and mainly within the European Union. Thank you.
Thank you, Åsa. You are a former politician yourself. What do you think is the main obstacle to get real good policies in place?
I think resistance within agriculture and food industry in many parts within the European Union.
Like where?
I'm not going to mention single countries. I mean, some countries is going in the direct direction and others not. But that's the main reason, of course. Otherwise, it would be easy. And one obstacle is, of course, to improve the legislation when it comes to animal welfare. And I would say that there is resistance more or less in almost all countries, but it varies, of course.
But what about the labeling, so we consumers can think for ourselves and then make us just more aware? Wouldn't that be enough?
I think that it wouldn't be enough, because it's very complicated for consumers to understand the labeling. And I think that most consumers are more afraid of antibiotics within the food itself. It's not very easy to understand the connection between the methods within agriculture and the use within agriculture and the threat towards human healthcare.
So we all need to have good ideas. We heard some good ideas how to inform about that connection in the
yes.
future.
Yes, that's really important. And I think a lot more has to be done, because it's not very easy to understand. It's quite similar to the issue of chemical compounds within food and the use in agriculture. It's very complicated for consumers to understand and to really get into all this kind of information. So I think responsibility has to be taken on a higher level. And I think that if the consumers understood the issue better, it would be much easier to take these necessary political decisions as well.
Thank you, Åsa Domé. And before we get to the breakout rooms, which will happen in a moment, I would like to hear from you, participants. Could you please write to me in the chat? Take a moment. What am I taking with me from the talk so far? Okay, Jenny Lundström is writing, I would like to see development in the EU with the criteria, these criteria, Ulf Magnusson, follow the money. And then Nina writes, stop focusing on the problem and look at the causes to the problem. Yes. Emma is writing, it's a complex problem, but clearly not unsolvable. The need of political decision 2.0. Gunilla writes, shared responsibility, market and consumers is not enough. And Max writes, one health perspective is important. Thank you. We'll continue to discuss in a more closed sessions now. Welcome back to the main room. I hope you had great discussions within the breakout rooms. And now it's about clearing the table. We will hear from you, and you will have about 2 minutes each from each room for sharing. And I would like to start with Helle. Hello, Helle. How is your group doing?
It was doing very well. We had a lot of interesting conversations back and forth. I'm just looking at my notes here to try to see if I can condense it a little bit, because it was going in a few different directions. But I think one key point that I would highlight there is, you know, people were very aware of the complexity of the issue, and that it required, you know, complex issue requires complex solutions.
there was a point made also that, you know, in all of this, yes, we do need to take a One Health approach, but we also need to take a, what we say, like a One Human approach, and really be mindful that solutions that might work in Sweden might actually not work somewhere else, and that we need collaborations and we need communications, that we need to be able to actually find joint ways forward that are able to take into account different levels of income, different level, different settings, different means of production, different ways of coming into the issue, and also understand that it might be different drivers that are leading to overuse in a country like Sweden versus a country like India, for instance. And just on the final point that was made also is that there is a need for us in this community to look at the movement on climate change and kind of learn the good lessons there, perhaps also the bad lessons on what not to do, but certainly on figuring out how do we lift it to get the political priority that climate change has managed to do, being relatively comparable in its wickedness to antibiotic resistance. So I'll summarize it like that.
Thank you very much, Helle, and the group. Hello, Ulf. What about your discussions?
They were good to start. And secondly, I think after all these extensive presentations, we were a little bit, several of us was thinking about what should we prioritize? Which is the main issues? Because we can't, or we can try to do everything, but it will be very, very hard. So that was one of line of discussions, prioritization and kind of risk assessment, which is the most important aspect to fight. And that works are of course very different in different contexts. Then another aspect was about communication. We're saying we have to communicate more and more and increase awareness. The name of this week is awareness. But then how do we do this kind of communication, and what do we communicate? We all know that knowledge not always translates into changed behavior or changed practices. So we should not be naive in this. We have to think through what we really want to achieve, and so that was another line of discussion. And the third was, could say it simply, cooperation and export of good practices. We in Northern Europe have a shared view that could be exported, we think, and it's so that is a kind of opportunity.
Thank you. And hello, Max, what did your group talk about?
Hello. Yes, we talked about many things, and we could have kept on talking for the rest of the day, it felt like, but it was nice, which is good. It was a small group. We talked about similar things that Ulf mentioned about communication. How do we communicate the issue to consumers? And then we also need to have in place some systems for transparency and traceability to be able to know about products. We also talked about knowledge, that knowledge is the key things at different levels, at the consumer levels, but also at the farmer levels. And we also talked about maybe some more root cause to the problem if we look at systems designs. And how are these systems that are representative also for the agriculture sector, intensive systems, what can be learned from the design there? How can we rethink about that to avoid having to treat animals? And also we talked about knowledge about alternative to antibiotic use, alternative methods like probiotics, etc. We talked about also about animal welfare, that that is something that is easily for consumer to comprehend, and it speaks to the consumers. Am I out of time now?
Sort of. Thank you, Max. I heard that you had a lot of interesting things going on there in your group. Okay. Hi.
We also had very interesting discussions. So I was so happy to see people from different backgrounds in the group. And of course, the point of concerns varies a little bit in between. We had a lot of discussion about the animal health. And of course, that we also raised again, as everyone said, this One Health approach. And also we talked about awareness that, that's very important for us to bring up any solutions, but of course, as well as we need we talked about the complexity of the problem, and sometimes we need for that to zoom out a little bit rather than to zoom in and get into the very details, and also the importance of communications and system transparency is what we outlined. And also it was a great point that was raised by one of our team, that we cannot put all the responsibility on the consumer, but rather than we need to come back and see from the beginning what has made, for example, has driving this overuse of antibiotics and has caused this problem, and start from there. But also, just to wrap it up, I want to say that we also talked a little bit about innovation, and that we have to set up a completely disruptive solution for this complex. And then maybe it's very dreamy, but we need academia, we need clinicians and regulatory authorities to come together, maybe sit even around the same table and discuss it and say that, now we have this problem and we can make things happen, and how we can assess the risk and the benefit, as well as thinking about the reimbursement, thinking about accessibility, thinking about affordability, and all this together.
Thank you, Sava. Sounds very interesting. And over to Elin then.
Yes, thank you, Sharon. So we also had a great discussion that kind of went back and forth between discussing push and pull factors, actually, to address this problem. And first, I just want to pick up on the climate change analogy that has been made several times here. And I think a few years ago, only a few companies had climate action embedded in their main strategies. But today, virtually every Swedish company has that. So why this transformative change? It's been a very quick change, actually. And I think the answer is because it's now demanded from the consumers. So climate change went from an issue being debated among experts to becoming an issue that we debate everywhere, at daycare, at dinner parties, and on the front pages of the newspapers. So I think that is a shift that needs to be happening for this topic as well. And the second quick thing that I wanted to pick up on was one of the push factors. And there in our discussion, we particularly highlighted that we need to put more focus on harmonizing policy with emerging economies, particularly.
Thank you very much, Elin. Maria now.
So we had really interesting discussions. We had participants in our group that were both focusing on in their daily work regarding seafood and farming of fish, which was really interesting to listen to, both when it comes to innovative solutions that were going on, but also that at least our fellow friends in our group said that you can actually see a positive development in the sea farms, shrimp farms in Asia, due to market requirements and to the fact that the knowledge is rising in this amongst these farmers. So it was really like a positive feeling regarding this. We also had participants, several of them in our group, that came from the business side. So we also had quite a good discussion regarding the market and consumer pressure. So and what they said was that, of course, the push for antibiotic is there. Maybe it's not as visual as for other sustainability issues, but it's there, and at least that will be a very good and very important thing for the development going forward. So market-driven forces is of course important, but we also talked about data together awareness raising, but that has been lifted by other groups. So I will pause there.
Thank you very much. And now over to Cecilia. Excuse me.
Yes.
Cecilia, hi.
Thank you. I think I'll probably be the last group presenting. So many of the things that we've discussed also raised by others, but it was really a good discussion. I think the most interesting piece is actually the one in trying to overlap knowledge between the three different areas that we have covered, agriculture, aquaculture, and the release of antibiotics directly to environment. All of them are somehow related to the power of consumers and how consumers can or cannot influence those pieces. And at least from our and my perspective, learning between those three would be very interesting going further. And also the power of legislation and how that the change of, you know, where legislation has an important role and perhaps a less important role. So we discussed that also. I think I'll stop there. Many of the conversations we had were touching, and many of you have already raised them.
Thank you. Gunilla, then.
We touched upon environmental issues. Sensed there was a need for partnership platforms or where partners could make contact. And we also discussed that despite common rules and regulations, you can see large discrepancies, for example, in the EU region. And all in all, to me, it seems that all the needs or many of the needs that are expressed are in place actually globally or in the EU or nationally to a very large extent, but we need to be better to make that common knowledge on where to look for partnership platforms. FAO has a partnership platform, for example, for private partners to create networks. So when it came to discrepancies despite common rules, we discussed the EU regulations that have been quite recently updated that will take care of most or many of the discrepancies on how we use antibiotics to animals, for example. One novel approach for solution that came up was behavioral change. I think Ulf mentioned that as well, because we know that many people know exactly what to do, but they still don't do it. So we need to incorporate and mainstream behavioral research science into how to tackle AMR. Yeah,
thank you, Gunilla. And the last group would be Åsa's group. Hi, Åsa.
Yes, thank you, Sharon. We also discussed many interesting, several things and have fruitful discussions. And it's not so easy to summarize everything, but to connect to other speakers, I'd like to say something about knowledge. We discussed the importance of knowledge. And then we meant that it's not just behavior, consumers' behavior that could be changed with more knowledge, because a human being is not only a consumer, a human being is also a citizen, and the citizen can put pressure on decision makers. Another thing we discussed was to also take negative impact on the environment into consideration and not focus only on human health. And then we also discussed maybe a little bit philosophical, that maybe we have to start talking of bacteria, not just to fight in war terminology, instead discuss how to coexist with bacteria. And we also said that at least something things is going in the right direction within the European countries, but not in all European countries. So in one way, we were a bit hopeful at least.
Wonderful to end up this with a hopeful thought and a hopeful message. Before we say goodbye to all of you, I would like to thank all the participants and the talkers and give the final words to Maria and maybe Elin. Thank you.
Yes, well, just a big thank you to every one of you. I've heard so many positive feelings and words today. Join forces, windows of opportunity, that will at least save my week. So just a big thank you from me. I don't know if Elin, maybe you want to add something to that?
Just saying thank you for everyone who shared their fantastic expertise and thoughts today.
And with that, I will conclude and promise that we will share both presentations and a recording of the main sessions, not the breakout rooms, but the main sessions. And thank you and keep up with the good work. Bye-bye from Stockholm.